Okay, thank you very much. So yeah, I will try to cover actually a number of levels of description and modeling in this time. So hopefully I will make it. If I don't, we can leave some stuff for the questions. But basically I want to cover really from very simple models to more complex ones at various levels of descriptions, and try to show the relation with COVID-19 at each level. So first, as an introduction, I want to say that the problem of infectious diseases is really not new. I mean, infectious diseases have been with humanity for a very long time, and we can remember, I mean, we don't remember, but we know about some events like Black Death in the Middle Ages. We know how the populations of the Americas have been almost wiped out by smallpox brought by white people. And so it's really not new, but we kind of seem to have a bit forgotten about it in our countries because there have been so great achievements, basically by hygienes, new medicines, vaccines, etc. And so it seems often that in our collective thinking in the Western countries, it's not so important, even if it is worldwide still a very important problem, is the second cause of death worldwide. And in addition, there are constantly, I mean, regularly, new emerging disease, infectious diseases coming on. Appearing, and this is data from the UK government, but it's basically data from the WHO. And we can think recently of Zika. Ebola has been on the news a few, then some time ago, SARS. But in the middle, there is also West Nile, chikungunya, other diseases that are brought to us by mosquitoes, by vectors whose habitat has expanded because of global warming, but which were already there in other countries. Simply, we don't see it in our countries. So this is just to put things a bit in perspective and to mention that COVID is something we haven't seen for certainly quite a long time, but the problem of infectious diseases and the issue worldwide of infectious diseases has been there for a long time, and many people have worked on that since a long time. And obviously, COVID-19 has kind of brought the world to a halt in a way that has never seen that we have never seen before. And we see here in the Financial Times there are lots of graphics which show the evolution of the disease, and starting from a disease that was mainly damaging China, Asia. It is now mostly, as far as we know, because there's a lot, certainly in lots of countries, we don't really know the real burden. It's hurting a lot the Americas, Europe, and so it has become really a worldwide issue. So in this context, obviously people have started thinking about modeling all these diseases, how they spread, how to contain them, how to mitigate them since a long time. And as we all know, I mean, we are physicists, so we know that reality is very complex, and you write models that are all wrong, but some useful to simplify the reality, to understand how basically the key mechanisms of the phenomenon, to understand theories, and to in the end to make some predictions, and in the case in particular of infectious diseases, compare scenario and make predictions about the toll that the disease will have and how different mitigation strategies could work. So I put it also at the end, but this is a title that I like because it's taking again this issue that models are wrong, but some are useful. It's a very nice blog by Bruno Gonzalez, who has worked a lot in this, and it's very pedagogical. So in the issue of modeling infectious diseases, I will talk about two aspects. First aspect is we want to model how the disease is evolving inside each individual, inside each host. And two, we want to model how it is transmitted between hosts. And that, of course, means understanding the mobility and the contact patterns of hosts, in this case, humans. And I just wanted to emphasize that in both aspects, there are many, many, many things we don't know. There are lots of parameters and so lots of assumptions that have to be made at various levels. So starting with the very basic of epidemic modeling, the basics is known as compartmental models. And basically what you do is you have a population of individuals and you forget about many things. You neglect the fact that the disease, in fact, has a gradual evolution in each person. So it starts, you might have just some symptoms, very light symptom, and then it becomes more severe, and then it decreases slowly for a while. So here you just schematize it by saying people are either susceptible, infectious, or maybe they're susceptible again when they recover, or removed or recovered, meaning they cannot become infectious again. So susceptible becomes infectious by contact, by interaction with an infectious individual with a certain probability per unit time. And then the infectious, they will recover with a certain rate also. These are the two basic parameters in the SIR or SIS model, the rate of infection by contact and the rate of recovery. And of course, in this very basic model, you also neglect differences in hosts, meaning age, gender, health, etc. And we know that in many diseases, all these characteristics of hosts can be important, but here we will just neglect them. In this case, it's very important also to look at the second aspect, which is how infectious and susceptible enter into contact. And the basics here is to make the what is called homogeneous mixing assumption. And it's basically a mean field hypothesis. So basically you assume that all individuals are equivalent. They all have the same number of possibilities of contacts per unit time or per in general, and that they can mix with any other individuals. So it means that every individual, that's where you see the mean field hypothesis, among its K contacts, will see exactly a density of infectious individuals that is exactly the average density in the population. And in this hypothesis, you can write very easily the evolution equation for the fraction of infectious in the population of N individuals. And it's just given, of course, you have the negative term, which corresponds to people recovering. And then you have susceptible individuals who can become infectious by contact with an infectious individuals. And that, and in each case, with probability beta per unit time. And so you have K contacts. Among these K contacts, a fraction I of T is infectious because you make this mean field hypothesis. And so you have this equation. And when you look at short times, when you have very few individuals that are infectious, you can just linearize and you see that you have this competition between infection and recovery, which is kind of intuitive. If you recover very fast, you don't have time to infect other people. If you recover very slowly, you have time to make contacts and to infect other people, and so the infection will win. So you have an exponential increase or an exponential decrease depending on this competition. And this competition is usually phrased in terms of what is known the R0, so the number of individuals that an initially infectious individual can infect over the time during which it is infectious. And this number is called the basic reproduction number, and it distinguishes, it is very, you've heard about it certainly, because if it's larger than one, it means that each infectious can contaminate more than one other individual, and so you can have an exponential growth in a fully susceptible population, while if on average this number is smaller than one, you will have extinction. And so it tells you how dangerous, in some sense, in terms of propagation, would be a disease. And you see here some various numbers that have been estimated for a number of recent diseases. It's important to note that this number is hiding a lot of things. I mean, it's in fact the average of a distribution of events. So there can be superspreading events. By chance, one individual will infect much more than R0. It's also defined at first when the population is fully susceptible. In the theoretical term, it's really defined in a fully susceptible population. And finally, in a finite population, even with R0 larger than one, you can also have stochastic extinction because the process, the equation I wrote is for the average, but of course you have a stochastic process. And in fact, usually you will see this kind of curve that the number of infections, the fraction of infections over time in a simple SIR model. And so you have the number of susceptible that decreases, the number of recover that increases, but that is just the average. And what you have really is a stochastic process with curves that are more like that. And in particular, if you look at the final fraction of cases, it has a distribution. So if R0 is smaller than one, basically you infect only a small fraction of the population. But even if R0 is larger than one, you can show actually you have a probability 1/R0 to have the epidemic goes extinct if you start from one individual. And so you can see that it can happen even with R0 larger than one that you your epidemic goes extinct. However, it gives really the very important concept of the epidemic threshold, meaning that if you look at the phase diagram, you have two phases according to this R0. If it's larger than one, then you have an epidemic that will spread. If it's smaller than one, it will go to zero. And given its simple form, you can also instantly understand how it can be decreased, what kind of measures. So you can either increase mu, so by treatments, for instance, antivirals. You can decrease beta, so the infectiousness of each contact, by treatments that decrease the viral load, but also by wearing masks, better hand hygiene, etc. And you can reduce K, which is the number of people that each individual can see, can be in contact with. And that goes from social distances to full lockdown in which you isolate people. And finally, you can actually also work on the S of T, that is the population of individuals that are susceptible at the beginning by vaccination and what is well known as herd immunity, meaning if you vaccinate a large enough population, fraction of the population, then the infectious individuals will mostly see people that have been vaccinated. The infectious individuals will mostly see people that have been vaccinated and lose occasions, possibilities to propagate. So that's a very well-known picture at this mean field level. Obviously, real diseases have more complex compartment structures than SIR, but basically, I mean, it's just adding compartments like exposed or latent, that's for influenza, for instance. You are susceptible, you get infected, and for a while you are not yet infectious. And then you might be infectious asymptomatics, meaning that you don't develop symptoms, but you still carry the virus. And then in this case, you might be less infectious than an infectious with symptoms. This is the case of the SARS, in which we had to model the fact that people were also hospitalized and then they had a different possibility to infect. And for the COVID, there are a number of models that are being used. But what is very, very important here with respect to influenza is that we have indeed, so if a susceptible becomes, is contaminated, the susceptible will become exposed and then will become infectious before the symptoms. So it's a pre-symptomatic infectious, and then can either be asymptomatic or develop various levels of symptoms. That is the model used by the INSERM group. So then you can just go to hospital or go to intensive care units. And the issue of pre-symptomatic infection is very, very important. That's a Nature Medicine that has been published recently. And basically, if you look at the time in which the day in which you have the onset of symptoms, the good hypothesis is the hypothesis of the SARS, in which people started having symptoms before being infectious. That means you can, as soon as they have symptoms, you isolate them, and then you kill the propagation. What seems to happen in the COVID, that is why it could propagate so much, it's very, very nasty because the infectiousness starts before the onset of symptoms. So that's something very unusual, but this in this paper they estimated that as much as half of the secondary cases were infected during the pre-symptomatic stage. So that makes it even, I will come back to that later, but that makes it even more important to do contact tracing and to isolate people before they have symptoms, in case they have been contaminated. So I will not go, there are of course competing models, but they all use the fact that you have this pre-symptomatic infection and that you have also asymptomatic. Then depending on what you want to do, you might change a bit. I will not talk more about this, and I will focus now on the issue of modeling how the propagation can occur between hosts due to mobility and contacts. Indeed, what I showed you before was the homogeneous mixing, which is this mean field hypothesis, which makes it very easy to understand the structure of the model, how it works. But obviously, real structure of contacts is much more complex, and you can go from simple to very realistic with agent-based modeling that are being used at a large scale, but that are less transparent for physicists. And so I won't talk too much about it. But you have structure of the society by age, by gender, by health status, by socioeconomic status. You have contact networks. I will talk a bit about that. And I will start by talking about multi-scale models. So indeed, even if now we are maybe all focusing a bit on the local scale, what's happening at our scale of the city, of the country, I want to go back a little bit because it's very important to understand the role of human mobility in this kind of crisis. Indeed, so that's what happened in the Middle Ages. You had the Black Death going through the whole of Europe in a few years. And basically the speed is here, the diffusion on the landscape was very important. It was, disease was traveling with people, meaning either by boat or on foot. And that's more or less the velocity of the disease. However, in the recent years, we've seen SARS, we've seen H1N1, and now COVID. We've seen how fast it goes from one place to another, obviously because of air transportation. And here I want to emphasize that even if it is important to obtain good models at the local scale, our point here already some years ago was to say we need also global approaches because as soon as you have such a big traffic by air transportation, it's enough that you have very few cases in a country for having a high risk of exporting infectious cases and to very far countries. So it's that was a simulation in this case of an influenza with parameters similar to an influenza. And we see that even if you start from one country very far from here, it could reach us and almost any country in the world before being detected locally. So we resort in this case to what we call what is called metapopulation model. And basically it is a multi-level description in which you have inside each geographical area, in our case it was each city, you assume still something very simple, homogeneous mixing, but you describe correctly the travel between between geographical areas. And in this case, we were using, and it's still pretty much used, kind of a random diffusion, even if there is some issues with that. But basically, inside each, so you use a compartmental model in which people can be in different states, and they can contaminate each other in the city, but they can also travel to another city and bring the disease to other cities. It's interesting to see that these approaches are really not new. Those are fundamental papers. But what has changed since these papers in which they use maybe the 30, 50 largest airports in the world, is that we have a much better understanding, availability of data and understanding of the data. So we have knowledge about population densities, we have knowledge about mobility, fluxes of travelers, even commuting, and we also know how to analyze, to understand this data. In particular, we actually came to this issue of modeling epidemics by the study of the air transportation network and its complex properties. So we developed in this paper in 2006, after we had studied this, in particular, we had shown how heterogeneous the air transportation is and how important it was to take into account the fact that various connections have so diverse fluxes on it, that some airports are so much larger than other airports, etc. And we developed a model that is basically an SIR model. So here you have the evolution equation of the SIR model inside each city, plus these omega terms that describe the transportation of susceptible, infectious, and recovered individuals between cities. So that basically we had, I think, data about 3,600 airports in the world. And what we did was to write these equations, of course, in the computer, and integrate, use them to describe the spread of a disease at the global level. And the first study we did, it was published in 2007, and that was our first interaction with epidemiologists, with Alain-Jacques Valeron at INSERM. We studied the possibility of a spread of an influenza. At that time, we had SARS or influenza in mind. And we looked at what happened with travel limitations. And we looked at what happens with a different strategy. We were assuming we had antivirals, because for influenza you have antivirals, but they were not in such big quantities. So what we showed was that travel limitations were not very effective. And here you know that we showed only 50% air reduction, air traffic reduction, because at that time it seemed to us totally wild. Even 50% traffic reduction seemed like crazy because it would hurt so much the global economy. I'll come back to that. We also thought about strategies in which you have limited stockpiles of antivirals, and we found kind of intuitively that basically you need a cooperative strategy because of this, because it's not really possible to close the borders. That's kind of unrealistic. And to hope that thing, I mean, the tempest will go raging outside of your country and you can remain in your own country with closed borders and your stock on a pile of antivirals. And in fact, allowing the WHO to have a global stockpile of antivirals to distribute it where it was needed, maybe it's a bit idealistic, but it was shown to be a very effective strategy. Starting from this model, my great colleagues, Alessandro Vespignani and Vittoria Colizza, actually developed even further this modeling. So starting 2008-09, and they developed this global epidemic and mobility model. So you can look it up on the web. It's a very, you can actually kind of do your own simulation, build your own favorite disease simulation. And so they developed this very elaborate model that takes into account not only the long range air transportation that we were using in this first version of the model, but also the commuting, which is obviously very important at local scale, and also much more detailed information on the population layer, so the population density. And inside each small geographic area, you still have a homogeneous mixing with the model you can design. So as you see, it started more than 10 years ago, and it has obviously evolved. Maybe that version 7, 8, something of the software. It's open software, you can do your simulation with it, and it's being used even now. And just to know that that was the first time it was deployed, that these people did really run the big simulations, was during the H1N1 crisis. And they were, during summer, actually predicting that the epidemic peak would come in autumn, much before the usual influenza epidemic peak, and that was confirmed afterwards. So basically, the simulations were saying already at that time, there were all the discussion about will the vaccine be ready, will the vaccine not be ready, and basically it was clear from the simulations that the peak would arrive before it was ready. Since then, obviously, they've used to come back to travel limitations. So they also did these simulations about what time would the travel limitations gain, and they were showing that even with very large limitation of travel, you would gain just a couple of weeks. And they even did a very, very nice paper with an analytical approach, obviously on idealized networks of transportation, that was showing that you have a global threshold below of travel, below which you can kill the global propagation, but this global threshold is like 10, 50 times lower than the actual air traffic. So it was very difficult to gain more than a couple of weeks. So this platform, they have also used it to make predictions of risk for various countries during the Ebola crisis, during the Zika crisis, and obviously they've been using it more recently. So if you look at this web page, if you Google Vittoria Colizza Lab, you will find it. It's the INSERM web page with all the reports. And already, so in January, they were estimating the importation risk to Europe in this framework. And even what they did was make the hypothesis that even after the Wuhan lockdown, in fact, there had been other cases probably to other provinces. And so there would be probably importation to Europe. And also, given the timeline of cases that were discovered in various countries, they were also estimating that probably many cases had been traveling under the radar, so either asymptomatics, maybe presymptomatics. That has been also estimated by the group of Vespignani, so that's the page of the group of Vespignani. And also there, they were looking at the effect of the travel ban, and they write explicitly in this paper in Science that even at the travel ban, most Chinese cities had already received infected travelers. So basically delayed, it gained a bit of time, but not so much. Because basically, as you see in the curves, it slows down, it kind of resets the curve of propagation, but it doesn't kill it completely, because whatever you can do is kind of already too late. And indeed, that's a very interesting paper that has been published. I mean, it's a preprint, I think, done recently by a careful analysis of cases in Italy. And I've heard that they are starting to do it in France also. And basically what they obtained retrospectively that already in January, there were already cases that were under the radar in Italy and very probably France. Okay, so we have this all this kind of understanding of what happens at the global level, but obviously now we have also to go to the more local level and to talk about the population structure inside the local level. And I will talk about two scales again. So first, as I was mentioning, we have differences in age, in gender possibly. And so at the local scale, that is often translated into using contact matrices that kind of tune the K, the number of contacts, depending on, for instance, your age. There are very few papers that include that into a metapopulation model. That's a very nice paper by the group of Vital Kolitsa in collaboration with Pablo Jensen and others, in which you have basically different groups, for instance, children and adults, taking into account that some maybe children travel less than adults, so that might be important. But for this, you need data to describe these contact matrices, and how do you get this data? Fortunately enough, the epidemiologists have not waited for the crisis to understand that it was important, and so they have done surveys. So the most data that we have come from surveys. This is a very famous paper for what is called a polymod survey, in which they ask people in 8 different European countries about basically who have you encountered today, what age was that person, how long, etc., what was the context, transportation, work, home, etc. And there's another paper by specific to France. So this is the paper in 2015. And so they look at the statistics of contacts of children, adults during holidays. Was there touching? Was that with, I think that's contacts, extra contacts at work, something like that. So, and you obtain these contact matrices that give you a lot of information of how people of different characteristics, in this case, age, mix. And you see that there is always a strong diagonal, which corresponds to the fact that all of us, we mix preferentially with people our own age. But you have also the off diagonals, which correspond, for instance, to parents and children, or to grandparents and children, etc. So this is a very important ingredient, and it is indeed taken into account in current modeling. For instance, this is a preprint by the INSERM group, and there's a very similar one by the PASTEUR group that use here. They use 3 types of individuals to make things simpler: children, adults, and senior. And you have the baseline, which is what would happen in normal times. And then you can plug in what is called interventions, meaning you assume the effect of staying home, telework of a certain fraction of the population, school closure or part closure, etc. To the contact matrix. And so then you can run again the simulation with these modified contact matrices and make some estimations. And so you have various levels of contact matrices describing contacts in households, at work, in transportation, etc. And therefore, depending on the type of interventions, you can modify one or the other, and then you combine things together again. What's very interesting is that, of course, here you have to do some assumptions about how the matrix, the contacts are modified by your interventions. But now we also have data, thanks to this very nice paper by Vespignani's group, in which they have surveys from China, Wuhan and Shanghai, about the number of contacts before the baseline period and during the outbreak. So here is really Chinese-like lockdown, not at all the French lockdown. But in any case, it shows you if you started from a certain R0, you have such a reduction of contact that you obtain R0 during the confinement, during the lockdown, that has decreased extremely below and much below one, which is what you want. So that's a very nice result. And indeed, then you can, as I was saying, use your favorite model of the COVID with these various contact matrices, either the assumed ones or also the Chinese ones. And then you can do some prediction about, of course, you calibrate the model. So this is results by the INSERM group. You calibrate your model on the data you have. And then you make a certain number of assumptions. What happens if you have the baseline, so no interventions? What happens if you have the lockdown? So you see it completely kills the peak. And if you relax the lockdown, as has been well said also by other groups, you risk a second wave. Then you can simulate a number of exit strategies using this partial interventions and try and so estimate the burden under a certain number of strategies. And I want to go a bit, because that's more my own work, on the even more local scale, which is really the taking into account the fact that the population is really structured with contact networks. And here we go to the realm of network epidemiology, in which you take into account that not only you have different ages, different characteristics, but you have each one has different number of contacts, and each person has different people they enter in contact with. So that's just a bit of self-advertisement, a book we had on general dynamical processes and complex networks. There's a chapter about network epidemiology, but this is a much more recent review, 2015. And I wanted also to show this this paper, which is about the fact that having data about networks between individuals is really very challenging. And indeed, the surveys, we know that they miss a number of contacts because you don't remember everyone. And also you might estimate badly the duration of contacts. So when you want to work with contact networks, you have, of course, the real world that is translated into a contact network by how you measure it. And depending on how you measure it, you will have different resolutions, you will have different biases. So it's important to keep in mind that all this data you will have is a bit noisy. So you can use diaries, surveys, and then you have for each individual, you know how many other individuals they have been in contact with, but you don't know the contacts between these contacts. You can use data from applications like Foursquare or other that have a GPS resolution that's very low resolution. It's collocation that is not necessarily meaningful in terms of real contacts. And then you can have sensors that are developed for this. And it has been, this kind of sensor have been used, developed and used by several groups since about 15 years, using different, starting with Bluetooth or Wi-Fi, but also with sensors that are really specifically developed for that in hospitals, in schools, at university. That's probably the biggest search study by the group of Sune Lehmann in Denmark, using smartphones with Bluetooth, which has a lot of problems, so we'll come back to that. But it's at least the smartphones were all the same because they were distributed to students. And in this context, we thought in starting 2008 with this colleagues of mine, fantastic Jean-François Pinton in Lyon, and Ciro Catuto at ISI, Wouter van den Broek at ISI, we had some chats with these guys, and we decided that it would be interesting to develop our own infrastructure to measure contacts in different contexts. And we wanted something that we could deploy in many different contexts. And basically, we used some RFID sensors, which are active, so they work with a small battery, and they emit very low power packet, data packets, so that you have a reception only at short distances and if people face each other, if they carry the badge as in a conference badge. And the first beacons actually were not able to do that, and it's Ciro Catuto who was able to program them, to reprogram them to do this job, which was given that these badges had a very, very low memory. That was an impressive task. And so we started deploying this infrastructure in many different contexts, and you can look at our webpage, it's sociopatterns.org, sorry, and many data sets are open. And what you obtain is a number of high resolution proximity networks between individuals in many different contexts, ranging from schools to hospitals or households. And that's the example of a hospital in which you see that the nurses have a lot of contacts, so it's very well known, of course, but it was nice to check that we were able to recover this kind of well-known results, that nurses have obviously a very important role and need to be to have priority in strategies for protection and hygiene. So the data we have are temporal contact networks. So about temporal network, if you're interested, this is a fantastic review by Peter Holmer of a few years ago. And so lots of very interesting theoretical points about temporal networks, but I don't want to go into that. And rather show how this data can help us in the context of simulations. And indeed, we had work on this issue, in particular with data in schools. So this is data we had collected in a primary school, and what's there are two features that are very important. So here you have each dot is a student, and you have these circles that are the classes, and you see that there are much more contacts inside each school. So this is a contact matrix between classes, tells you how many contacts between children of different classes, and the contacts between classes, they all take place at the same time. So that's pretty important. We see that there are almost no contacts between classes at some times, and then you have all the contacts between classes. And already in 2011, so I was pretty happy to get back to that paper, we understood that it could suggest intervention strategies, first to close just one class or few classes if you detect cases, but also the idea that if you shift the class schedules, then you will remove the contacts between classes. And as I will show, we know that it is important. So this is indeed a publication 2011. And so we did these simulations with, here we had the idea of an influenza, emerging influenza. So no vaccine, but not such a severe thing as COVID, so we were not thinking about, you know, closing all the country. We're thinking, okay, we know it's efficient to close schools, but it's costly. So could we, what happens if we just close the classes where the infectious individuals are detected? And knowing that there are some asymptomatics, so there could be people you have not detected that are already infectious in other classes, so it's not perfect. But we're showing that it was, you know, closing two classes instead of 10, the whole school, would already have some interest, some good impact. Another obvious impact that has been talked about is looking at half classes, because going back to the R0, inside one class, you can more or less say it's a mean field. They are all in contact with each other. So if you decrease the average degree, so the degree is basically the number of people in the class. So if you decrease that by two, well, you decrease the number of contacts by two, you decrease the overall contact time of children by four, and obviously you will have a very strongly reduced risk of infection within the class and within the school. So that's kind of obvious. What's also kind of obvious from a network epidemiology point of view is that in the school, we have the structure of classes with links between classes that are not so many, but that are very important. So here the structure is important and not only the K. And it's these links have what is called high betweenness centrality. It means basically that they are on many potential paths of transmission of information or disease, whatever, within the network. So it's known that if you cut them, you will have an important effect. And here, it's, that's basically what's important is that we know they are synchronized, and so it's doable. And that's more or less what we did in a more complex way in this preprint. We never went to submit it, actually. But we have a technique that is based on tensor decomposition to basically separate the contact network between various components, and some of these components you can interpret them as the breaks, and they correspond to contacts between classes. And then we did simulations of standard model of spread with reasonable assumptions, and we're showing that if we remove these components of the temporal contact network, there are actually few links, but the removing them has a very strong effect on the spread. And I did it again with a COVID-like spread. And basically, if you remove the almost all the class, the contacts between classes or between grades or between years, you can, and that you can do it in practice because these links are synchronized, you can show that indeed your epidemic size will decrease very strongly. So it's, as I was saying, it's kind of well known in network epidemiology, but it's important that it is here actually something you can act on, and it's not really abstract, an abstract way of doing an intervention. If I have just a couple of minutes, I can say a few words about contact tracing, which has been a lot on the news also. So contact tracing basically is based on interviewing cases that have been identified. And there are some definitions of what is a low risk or high risk contact that is, of course, evolving as one knows more about the disease. But basically, the point is if somebody is detected as infectious, then you ask that person to identify who they have been in contact in the last N days, few days, 7 days, 2 weeks. And then you tell those, you call those persons and tell them, look, you've been in contact with somebody who is infectious, who has now symptoms. So there is a possibility that you've been infected. So you should go into self-isolation, please. And it means, of course, that some of these people have indeed been infected, some have not. So you will quarantine people who have not been infected, that is false positive, but with respect to, let's say, a global confinement of the whole population of the country, it's obviously much less. And here, as I was mentioning before, it is particularly important in the case of COVID because infections occur well before the symptoms. And so when the people is reporting symptom is identified as carrying the virus, maybe a few days before they had absolutely no symptoms, but they infected a friend, family, or some people they were in contact with. The issue is that, so it's being done. It was being done before stage 2 and 3 of the epidemics. It stopped being done because there were too many cases to interview everyone, but it's still being done in the departments that have a low circulation of virus. It's time consuming. It can take a lot of time to warn people, and it misses a number of people because you don't remember, or you met people in the store, in wherever, in the transportation, that you don't know. So you cannot warn them. That's why there's been a lot of discussion about doing it with an app. And that's very, very important. Sometimes it has been discussed as if it were something that could be, that could replace usual contact tracing, and it's never been that, because it cannot. It would be crazy to think that you can replace this human intervention by an app, but it can augment by warning, and warning in a short time, people who have not been, who have been in contact, who are not maybe acquaintances, or who the case did not remember. And here, so you've probably seen this kind of illustrations. There are many, many, many issues from ethical to technical, because it uses Bluetooth. Bluetooth is very bad at measuring distances. That's the issue of data protection, or the centralized versus decentralized. And my bet, my personal bet, is that in France, it will just not happen. It will happen, nobody will use it, because the government has drawn the centralized model, which is not the most privacy preserving. And so, just because they don't want that Google and Apple tell them what to do. But the main issue is that the result is probably it won't work on iPhones, and it might not work on Androids, except if your phone is on all the time, so your battery will be drained and nobody will use it. Anyway, many, many issues, but it has been like advertised a lot with this paper, in which it shows that basically if you have 60% of contacts that are quarantined, then you can work. I mean, it can work if it's instantaneous, meaning you need an app to send people, to send a warning fast. However, it's interesting, this Kucharski and et al. Paper manuscript also is very nice, because it estimates what happens if you have just manual contact tracing or if you have app contact tracing. And actually, a normal contact tracing is more efficient, because with the app, you need both the case and the contact to have the app. So it's quadratic. And indeed, I did some simulations in with some data from sociopatterns with this model of COVID. And obviously, I mean, it's kind of trivial. You need both the case and the contact to have the app. So it's, the effect is quadratic in adoption. So there's no magic number like I mean, there's probably no magic number anyway, but it's true that the efficiency at low adoption is limited. It can, maybe it can gain a bit of what you want, but it's limited. So to just one thing to say, that there's also a lot of discussion about masks, and of course it would have been better to tell it from the start that masks are important. I mean, no, Asian countries which have lived through SARS and other crises know, you go to China, you go to Japan, they all wear masks, that must be a reason. And so please, if you go outside, wear a mask if you have one. I don't, because I still have to go out to buy one. And just so to summarize, there's basically no magic bullet. We need a lot of efforts working from home as much as possible. If you can continue, please, until I don't know, till summer, that's what I will do. Of course, if we want to reopen classes, we have to do it with, if possible, half classes, avoid as much as possible the mixing between classes, shift the schedules also at work, do social distancing, wear a mask, wash hands, test, because once again, test is important. We have a health minister that said, well, you know, I mean, if we had tested all the people, it wouldn't have changed. That's just, I mean, okay, I won't qualify that. Contact tracing is certainly important, with or without app. Probably without app is enough. App could maybe get something more and quarantine people when they are identified, or if they can self-isolate, give them possibility to do it in hotels, in structures. And just further reading for people who want to look at some nice more or less divulgation blogs. So the INSEM page is has all the reports. There's this Thomas Puello that I didn't know before, but his pages on Medium are just fantastic. This NK's about, it's 30 minutes read with a lot of apps, small applets, that is just fantastic, also by Marcel Salate, who is a very important guy in digital epidemiology. Also, Bruno Gonzalez has a very nice blog, and much better than this, the present talk tomorrow, that's this colloquium by Alessandro Vespignani from Northeastern at ICTPCSA. So luckily I was before him, because else I'm not sure I wouldn't have canceled my speech. So thank you very much. And I hope that it answered just some of your questions.
Okay, thank you, Alain. Je peux applaudir tout seul si tu veux.
No problem.
Thank you very much. Okay, so if you want to ask a question, you can raise your hand in the chat, and I will try to give your name. So go ahead. Okay, so while you're looking for the small button. Okay, so Benjamin Wandelt, you can ask your question if you want.
Hi, I have a couple of questions. Ways of building in non-linearity into the model, because clearly the model is and change.
I don't hear you. I hear just very partial.
Non-linear is something that's taken into account in some of the models.
So the models are not linear, because you have a product between the density of infectious and the density of susceptible, which is 1 minus the density of infectious, even in the simplest case. So you linearize at first, but then the whole model is not linear.
I'm talking about a different non-linearity, the non-linearity that comes about because the model informs policy, and the policy has an impact on the model.
Yeah, okay. So there's a very interesting field, line of research, in which you plug in awareness of the disease, and you have this kind of retroaction, and it so I have done a couple of papers on that, but there's a very nice line of research. Basically what it does is that your beta would be a function of either it could be the global infection in the population, it could be a function of your own contacts. If you have many infectious around, then you take more precautions, so your own beta will decrease. And then, depending on the hypothesis, you could shift the epidemic threshold, or in many cases, you cannot really shift it because it's in the equation, it comes at a second or third order terms, and the epidemic threshold, you see it in the linear part, but it will decrease in the phase above the epidemic threshold, it would decrease the incidence. So it depends on the hypothesis you make. And one very big difficulty is that you don't really know what hypotheses are good, in the sense you don't really know how people do react individually. Then what we're talking about here are really imposed from above, which means that it's not really a retroaction, it's rather, okay, panic, let's cut everything down. So it's not, it's kind of a threshold effect. and then you just change in the model the contact matrix, or you put a reduction of the number of contacts, all these kind of things.
Okay. Martin?
Yes. Thank you for a very nice talk. You talked about testing, and I was wondering, is there any interesting work or insight about what is the most efficient way of organizing or deciding whom to test with a limited amount of resources?
I'm not sure. I think that's probably some things that have been done more towards maybe towards computer science. Here the problem is that testing, when you talk to public health people, they would actually tell you that it's better not to test non-symptomatic people, because the only thing you gain by testing someone who is not symptomatic, okay, you have some little chance to have that person symptomatic, but positive, but if the test is negative, the only thing you gain is to test again the next day, except if that person is, even if that person is isolated, because you have incubation. So for instance, the even in contact tracing, when you isolate people, you should look at what time was there since the contact, and depending on that, you might not want to test right away, because if the person has just been infected, then that person would be negative, even because the viral load has not grown enough. So it's very complicated, and if you have limited resources, probably you need to test mostly people who have symptoms.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, other question? Yes, Yasha?
Thank you very much for your talk. I have a quick question. I guess in your models, you're assuming somehow that if someone gets this disease, then they will not get it again, right? Or you're having this factor that maybe they will have, with some probability, they will get it again.
No, here we have models in which when you recover, you are immune. So it's this kind of model. So once you arrived in the recovered compartment, you are immune. To the best of the actual present knowledge, it is true. Nobody knows how long it lasts, because that's like that. But the assumption is currently that it lasts at least weeks, probably month, but nobody has a clear certainty about that. So indeed, that's of course why there were some headlines about maybe some people who had were again positive afterwards. Interpretation seems to be that either there had been false negatives in the middle, or the tests were false positive, or there can be you can still have some pieces, some bits of the virus inside your body, even if you it's inactive. All the models right now are under this assumption.
So question?
May I ask a question?
Yes.
Thank you. And thank you for this nice talk, but some people have said that the main effect of the lockdown is to avoid hospital to receive more patients than they can treat, and that's clear. However, is it clear that in the long run, the integrated casualty is changed by a lockdown policy?
That depends. If you maintain the lockdown indefinitely, yes. The argument of the UK when they started saying no lockdown was exactly this. It was, okay, you have crushed the first peak, but then you'll have a second wave that will arrive anyway. And so let's do the herd immunity and in the end, the number of people, of victims will be the same. Except when they saw the numbers, then they freaked out and understood that it was not possible. Because on the one hand, the point is that there is indeed the point of reducing the load of hospitals, because if you can treat people anyway, it's not the same. You still have a smaller number of deaths. And so if, for instance, there was a scenario of recurring lockdowns to, you know, each time it goes up again to crush it. And in the end, you would reach immunity by small steps. But in the meantime, you gain time for the vaccine to arrive. And then you have had immunity without having this toll of dead people. So if you let a second wave arrive, yeah, it won't change much. If you have the first wave that has been put down, that's the message in this here, the hammer and the dance, in which the hammer basically is to crush down the first wave, and the dance is, you know, to do the measures that limit the propagation, to keep it as little as possible, so that you can treat people, trace cases, and so crush again more and more the curve, and wait for the vaccine with this dance that helps to have a small number of cases at the time.
There is another question on the chat from Ludovic Brivali, who is asking about the possibility of oscillations. If there is a threshold for the generation of these oscillation of epidemic waves. I guess the question is probably what are the conditions for which need to be met for generating some waves like that.
So you need that in the original model in the population, you need that you replenish the pool of susceptible. So if you have an SIR model, you will just have the one wave and that's it. You don't have enough susceptible again at the end. So you need for the infection to start again, you need more susceptible that can be contaminated. So you can have that either by an SIRS model, in which you lose the immunity after a certain time, but in which not too long time, because else your disease has totally vanished. Or you need to take into account demography. So new birth and death in the population. And so you need something that is very, that is happening on very long time scales. So in all cases, it's like it's like population dynamics. I mean, you need to replenish the pool of people who can become infectious.
Okay, thank you. More questions? So I was wondering, regarding to the contact tracing app, the duration of the contact might be a strong, an important variable, in the sense that, for example, in big cities, you are in contact with a contact of a few seconds or minutes with a lot of people. So how do you choose the duration above which you call people?
So that's there are some criteria that are indeed. Here, so you have a close contact. In the usual contact tracing, that's why you need interviews. You need to know if it was really like touching less than 1 meter or like just talking a couple of meters apart. And also in the interview, you can ask if like there was a plexiglass wall in between, if you are wearing a mask, etc. So you can really, the person doing the interviews need a bit of training to categorize the contact as low risk or high risk exposure. And it's really distance and duration. That's another problem with the app, is that you cannot have that. And so you will have lots of false positive, false negative, because of the approximate measure, because of the fact that you don't know the circumstance, and you don't know the protection, potential protection. But it's kind of the underlying hypothesis, which is always made in epidemiology, is that the probability, that's kind of a constant probability per, that's a constant rate of infection if you have the contact. And so the longer the contact, the higher the risk of transmission. Obviously, it's still an assumption, because if you sneeze, or if you, even if you talk, it's not the same as if you are silent in terms of risk of propagation. So there is always some kind of assumption, but yeah, and then they put kind of a, it's obviously kind of an arbitrary threshold at some point, you know. And there's still a lot that is unknown in terms of, you know, being in an aircraft, being in a bus. There's a lot that is unknown.
Thank you. Is there other questions? So maybe I can ask one more question. What about, so if there is some time dependence of the virulence of the virus, for example, seasonal behavior, how can you take it into account, and how is it modifying the policy that you?
So for the modeling of influenza at the global level, for instance, you take that into account typically. And that's why you have waves that are different in the two hemispheres. So you just put a factor that is time dependent, that follows the seasons. Here it's quite unknown. The indications are that it's not very strongly dependent. And actually, if you think about the cov-like viruses, there's the MERS-CoV, which is in Arabic countries. And this SARS-CoV has been also in Singapore. So it doesn't look like it would change a lot. In any case, what in the modeling, you can just put like a beta that depends on the specific day or the month, and that is likely, and then you can make a hypothesis, and you could then compute how much this factor has to be for it to go extinct. But I wouldn't count too much on that.
Okay. Thierry, I have a question.
Yes, thank you for the talk. I would like to know if you have some understanding of why there are so few casualties in India.
No, I don't. The number of casualties is something that is heavily underestimated in all countries. For instance, counting people who die in facilities for elderly has been done just after some time in France. In UK, it was counted only after there was intense pressure from the journalists, and suddenly you had, I don't know, thousands of new deaths one day, and it was just because they were counting that. The people who die at home are not counted. And in countries in which you have ample areas with no good health systems, no good hospitals, you will have lots of people who die at home and who are not reported. And it starts to be now to come out from, as usual, I mean, the real mortality is known when you have the statistical data about the number of deaths, and you compare to a usual year. That's what how it was done during H1N1, during any specifically bad influenza year or during the heat wave. And here it starts to, we start to have data in Italy, I think also a bit in France, and it's obvious from this data that the official number of deaths is totally underreported. The other reason could be that people die in hospital, but they have not been tested. So I don't know how it is working currently in India. I don't really have an explanation. There are lots of possibilities. It's possible that for some reason they enforced the lockdown early enough to have a stronger effect. That's another possibility. The earliest you do it, it has a very strong effect because your curve at the start is exponential. So losing 1 week can be very important, or being early 1 week can have a very strong important is crushing the curve. So I don't have a definite answer. There are so many factors that can enter.
Thanks.
I have a question.
Yes, go ahead.
Is there a simple way of explaining why in a school one should limit the inter-classes contact, the contact of contact between classes?
Yes.
And does the rector know about that?
I think they know about it because, so the very simple way is that in any network in which you have a structure with dense areas that are called usually communities, and then you have links between communities, if you have an infectious individual in one community, the contamination will spread easily in that community because it's very dense, you have many contacts, but it's since there are few opportunities to jump in these what are called, they are called bridges also, between communities, then naturally the infection will have a harder time to go out. And if, on the other hand, if you cut them, so if you remove these contacts, there are not so many, so it's probably more doable than removing all the contacts, isolating everyone. But then if your community is isolated, it spreads in that community, but all the rest of the population is safe. Obviously, that is not taking into account the fact that people then have contacts elsewhere, etc. But if we're talking just one environment, it's very, very useful. And I've heard, I've read actually about the idea of having not too many kids in the courtyard at the same time. So sending them one class at a time, or maybe two classes at a time. So I think that clearly they understand that.
Thank you. Fully.
And that's not, that's really not rocket science, I would say.
Do we actually know where most of the infections happen? In shops, in the metro, at work, or?
We don't know that. There have been even the role of children is kind of debated. There's been an investigation in a high school in Oise where they saw that there were quite a lot of transmission at the high school level. On the other hand, there are other evidence that show that there have been very few transmission by children. So it could be that there are actually a big difference between young children and adolescents. As I was saying at the beginning, there are so many unknowns, and there are some data, some coming in from various investigations, but it's very difficult to have a clear global picture. Also because you have so many confounding factors in each case. You have a lot of comorbidity. So in terms of where, a natural hypothesis globally is that it's proportional to the time you spend basically in the same space, meaning that working place, open spaces, for instance, high schools are, or schools are places where you have so many contacts, much more than at work. At least if you have separate offices, you know, not so many problems. And you have lots of contacts in a canteen, obviously. I mean, people go there to and of course scientific conferences. You know, I mean, that's a good reason why we shouldn't have scientific conferences for a while, unfortunately.
Thank you. Is there another question? Yes.
Bonjour. Qu'est-ce qui reste comme place pour les calculs exacts? Parce que le modèle du R0 qui correspond à deux choses différentes, à la fois le taux de contagion et ça permet de calculer l'immunité de société. Ça, c'est un résultat qui date de 100 ans et qui est quand même très solide.
Ouais.
On peut imaginer d'autres résultats du même genre avec des modèles très simples et un peu plus riches.
Bah, dans ce qui est justement de l'étude de ces modèles sur réseau, les résultats les plus importants ne datent pas d'il y a 100 ans. Ils commencent à dater eux aussi, quoi, mais c'est plutôt les années 2000 où justement la prise en compte par des méthodes analytiques hein, de la structure des réseaux a montré que le R0, ben, dans ces cas-là, c'était beaucoup plus compliqué. Et là-dessus, justement, il y a cette revue de 2015. Il y a des calculs analytiques, mais en exact, mathématiquement exact, il y a très très peu. C'est des approximations de type champ moyen hétérogène, donc champ moyen amélioré quand même. Il y a des méthodes de style qu'on appelle individual based mean field qui ont à un moment donné essentiellement t'écris tout de façon exacte, à un moment donné tu négliges des corrélations et tu montres que le seuil épidémique c'est l'inverse de la plus grande valeur propre d'une matrice. Donc il y a des résultats exacts récents, enfin exacts à la physicienne quand même un petit peu, dans des approximations de champ moyen. Sur les réseaux temporels également, le seuil épidémique dans des approximations de même style, donc en partie champ moyen, ça a été dérivé très récemment. Donc non, il y a encore de la place hein, pour des approximations de plus en plus raffinées. Récemment, on a fait un petit papier où on va au-delà du réseau, ce qu'on appelle les complexes simpliciaux, où essentiellement on tient en compte des structures un peu plus grosses que juste les liens. Et là, pareil, on a fait des résultats de champs moyens qui pourraient sûrement être affinés. D'ailleurs, on travaille avec des collègues pour les raffiner. Donc non, il y a du boulot hein, aussi. Là, je ne vous ai pas trop montré ces choses-là parce que c'est un peu plus difficile de les appliquer au Covid. Mais il y a des choses.
Merci.
Bon, la question de Bernard est, est-ce qu'il y a un modèle bien précis, bien défini, mais où il manque la dérivation analytique de ses propriétés?
Ça dépend un peu de ce que tu appelles analytique. Hein. C'est-à-dire que, encore une fois, le modèle SIS ou SIR sur réseau, il est résolu dans des approximations. Alors, qui sont très bonnes, hein, qui ont montré des effets super intéressants. Comme le fait que le R0 il va à zéro, enfin, le seuil épidémique va à zéro dans les réseaux hétérogènes. Et il y a eu beaucoup de débats pour savoir si c'était vraiment zéro, si c'était zéro que dans la limite champ moyen, etc. C'était quoi exactement ta question?
Ouais, est-ce que tu peux nous donner un modèle bien défini, sans trop de paramètres, sur lequel tu aimerais bien qu'on te donne une solution analytique de ses propriétés?
Par exemple, justement, les modèles, on a rajouté des contagions à effet de triangle. Nous, on a juste une version champ moyen. Mm-hmm. Essentiellement, la contagion, elle peut tu as deux paramètres. Tu as le paramètre qui est le paramètre habituel, le bêta. Et chaque fois que tu as un triangle dans ton réseau, si tes deux autres voisins sont infectieux, tu as une probabilité en plus qui est parce que tu es en train de discuter en triangle. Donc, on a parlé plus de contagion sociale parce que c'était un peu l'effet du renforcement par une conversation à trois. Et là, on a une solution qui est champ moyen, mais donc qui est forcément et qui est intéressante parce qu'en fait, tu passes d'une transition qui est continue, qui est la transition habituelle, à une transition discontinue. Donc, tu as avec une bistabilité. Donc, c'est assez joli. Et la solution qu'on a, elle est en champ moyen. Ça, je ne sais pas si ça pourrait être un exemple intéressant.
Ouais, je posais une question.
Oui.
Ce que j'ai posé déjà à Georges Opaïs sur son séminaire, mais il dit qu'il ne savait pas.
Tout de suite là.
Pourquoi est-ce que toutes les courbes de contamination montrent presque la même vitesse dans le stade exponentiel, plus ou moins le doublement en deux jours, si on regarde les pays complètement différents? Est-ce qu'il y a une explication à cette constante universelle?
Ça, c'est un peu le R0 du modèle, parce que tu as des populations totalement susceptibles et dans un régime où tu n'as pris aucune mesure, ça croît. Voilà, les populations ne sont pas tellement différentes. Je pense que c'est simplement ça. Pardon ?
La densité de population est différente, c'est bizarre, parce que vraiment les pays complètement différents montrent.
Ouais, oui, c'est vrai, c'était d'ailleurs un argument pour dire une semaine avant l'Italie, il faudrait fermer, s'il vous plaît, vu qu'on voyait bien qu'on était engagé sur l'exponentiel, et on voit bien que les gouvernants ne savent pas ce que c'est que l'exponentiel. Non, effectivement, c'est un truc un petit peu étonnant qui tend à dire que vraiment au début, la densité de population, elle n'est pas tellement importante.
Oui.
Ce qui paraît effectivement un petit peu contre-intuitif parce qu'au début, on se dit quand même le nombre de contacts. Ça peut vouloir dire que le nombre de contacts importants sur lesquels ça peut vraiment se propager, il n'est pas si énorme. C'est-à-dire que ça pourrait tendre à dire que les contacts rapides qu'on a, ils ne sont pas si importants et que finalement c'est les contacts vraiment longs qu'on a et ceux-là ils ne sont pas tellement différents. J'ai pas de certitude là-dessus, j'avoue. Bon, ceci étant, si Giorgio n'a pas de certitude non plus, ça me rassure.
Merci. Il y a aussi ça propage d'abord dans les là où la densité est grande probablement, non?
Oui, c'est ce qu'on a vu en Italie,
la plus grande dans un pays.
Ouais.
New York, on a bien vu que c'est...
Alors, c'est non seulement là où c'est grand, mais en plus, oui, ça arrive dans chaque pays par les aéroports les plus grands. Et donc, là où c'est des densités de population assez grandes.
Peut-être que ça commence par les villes où la densité est
C'est clair. Ça, c'est clair que la distanciation... Les gens qui sont dans la campagne, dans des bleds, avec qui on interdit d'aller à plus d'un kilomètre de chez eux, c'est totalement débile. Ouais. Ça, on le sait tous. C'est clair que c'est de même que quand au début, ils avaient dit à pas plus de je ne sais plus combien de personnes dans un endroit. Et là, le physicien en nous se dit non, mais ce n'est pas un nombre, c'est une densité, la chose importante. Quoi. Mm-hmm.
Merci.
Est-ce qu'il y a une explication de ce que j'ai essayé à faire, à superimposer les courbes des morts et des cas en translatant en temps et en translatant en amplitude sur l'échelle log? Ça marche pour la plupart des pays, sauf que, comme par exemple l'Iran, je pense qu'ils trichent dans les nombres, mais il y a une forte différence entre pays. Par exemple, en Allemagne, il faut shifté en temps par 12 jours, tandis qu'en Italie, plutôt par 4 et en France par 5-6.
Là encore, on rejoint la problématique des chiffres officiels qui arrivent avec du retard. Alors qu'il y a une translation, c'est naturel vu que la durée enfin, la maladie dure un certain temps. Il y a plein d'effets qui font que les chiffres sur les morts, c'est pas forcément l'indicateur le plus fiable. On sait pas. Il y a eu des discussions, je ne sais pas s'ils en sont sortis, de est-ce que les Allemands y reportaient les morts par Covid, enfin de Covid, ou des gens qui mouraient et avaient le Covid. Bon, il y a plein de problématiques comme ça. Et ensuite, ça peut être les remontées des chiffres. Enfin, on voit bien le lundi, il y a plus de morts que le dimanche, quoi, parce que c'est juste que les chiffres arrivent en retard. Je sais pas, honnêtement, ça c'est beaucoup des stats, hein. Enfin des stats en quelque sorte, c'est-à-dire des problématiques de comment les nombres sont reportés, au bout de combien de temps, avec quelle fiabilité. Et donc, je suis pas sûr. Ensuite, est-ce qu'il y a des problématiques sur est-ce que les Allemands sont meilleurs à soigner, par exemple? Ça, j'en sais rien.
Ils sont certainement moins sous stress parce qu'il y a des moitiés d'hôpitaux qui sont vides.
Bon, en France, on n'a pas été. Enfin, heureusement, ils ont pu doubler le nombre de lits. On n'a jamais été sous tension comme en Italie du Nord. Hein. Il faut aussi se rendre compte de ça. Et à Paris, vous êtes sous tension, mais nous, ici, les hôpitaux, ils ont, enfin, les lits Covid, ils n'ont jamais été plus pleins que 40-50%, je crois.
Bernard, il y a une question. Non ?
Tu me parles ?
Oui.
Pas tout à fait d'accord avec les chiffres de Kazakov, parce que la période, ce n'était pas 4 jours, 2 jours, c'était 4 jours. Au moment où la Chine a commencé à stabiliser.
Oui, pardon. Je voulais poser la question suivante. Bon, on a évoqué la question des relations intergénérationnelles qui sont effectivement plus intenses en Italie, où par ailleurs les gens se touchent énormément comparés, par exemple, au Japon. Est-ce que la modélisation supporte ce genre de conséquences comme étant un facteur primaire, vraiment?
La modélisation, elle va justement être enseignée par les matrices de contact qui te donnent et qui vont dépendre des pays. Les matrices de contact, elles sont quand même assez semblables. Enfin, elles sont pas égales dans les différents pays, mais elles ont certaines caractéristiques qui sont assez similaires.
Ça comme étant une explication essentielle pour le cas de l'Italie. Est-ce que vraiment les calculs supportent ça?
Non, je ne pense pas que ce soit une explication absolument essentielle. Le cas de l'Italie, d'une part, ils n'ont pas eu de chance, hein, parce qu'il y a un moment donné, il y a aussi chance et pas chance. Hein, l'explosion à Mulhouse, c'est aussi un truc pas de bol. Il y a eu un événement de supracontamination au début. Et puis, c'est des zones hyper concentrées, hyper urbaines, tout le nord de l'Italie. Donc, le nombre de contacts en termes absolus est probablement très élevé. Et il n'est pas impossible, en tout cas, il y a quand même des choses qui donnent à penser que la pollution atmosphérique, qui est absolument catastrophique dans tout le nord de l'Italie, a pu jouer un rôle. Pas seulement, alors que ça aide à la transmission ou pas, ce n'est pas clair, mais simplement parce que les gens ont une précondition, de même, il y a plus d'asthme dans les grandes villes à cause de la pollution. Je pense que ça peut aussi avoir joué un grand rôle. Parce que le sud de l'Italie n'est pas tellement touché. Enfin, il y en a un petit peu, mais donc c'est vraiment les zones. Alors, c'est parti du nord. Il se trouve qu'au nord, il y a quand même beaucoup de contacts, hein, parce qu'il y a une grosse densité de population. Et en plus, ils ont un air qui est pollué, mais vous n'avez pas idée, quoi. Même par rapport à Paris, c'est largement pire.
Bon, est-ce qu'il y a d'autres questions ou est-ce qu'on peut peut-être s'arrêter là? S'il n'y a plus d'autres questions, eh ben, on te remercie à nouveau, Alain, pour ce séminaire très clair et surtout la discussion qui a suivi, là, qui je pense éclaircit encore plus les choses.